Hi, this is Jim Janicey, and we're now into the 18th chapter in the Gombrich textbook, Story of Art. Here we're going to be looking at Europe in the era just immediately following the Renaissance, starting about 1550 and moving on into the 17th century. This is an era of strange things. It was a pretty tough act to follow the Renaissance masters, and artists went in two directions. They either tried to mimic them, or they tried to do outlandish things that were novel. And here an architect, Zaccaro, came up with kind of an interesting sort of a window. You'll notice here that it has some aspects of a Greek architecture with this kind of a roof here and these sorts of, not really columns here, but little shapely things. But it's really shaped like a grotesque mouth. Novel, it would capture your attention, but I don't think it would be a lasting sort of a thing that would be perpetuated. Novel, trying to make a name for yourself by doing something novel. Here's another one. Palladio had an awful lot to do with architecture in this era. This was one of his experiments where he attempted to design a house where every one of the four sides of it looked like a small Greek temple. Well, it was kind of interesting, and then in the middle he had this dome. Anyway, you approach this thing here, or in behind, it looked like a Greek temple. But really, it resulted in an arrangement of rooms that wasn't all that practical for a house. So another sort of an experiment. An architect might have done something very novel here to make a name for himself. Now here we have Cellini, who was a very flamboyant person who described a lot of his life, told it in very positive ways, very venturesome and all sorts of interesting stories. Gombrich doesn't like this. He thinks it's a little too affected or a little just too much playing to common tastes, I suppose. Perhaps he thought that the artwork wasn't all that well defined here in the body. But if you take a look at this, this is how the land and the sea, here's the sea and the land intertwined. And you see all these waves around here, and very richly done in gold and enamel. And it's really just for the king's table, a place to store some salt and pepper. I find this kind of very nice, and nicer than many of the unusual things, the novel things of the age. Here's something strange, though. Parmigianino, in this era that was called Mannerism, where some attempted to portray things in the manner of the Renaissance masters, and others like Parmigianino went off in rather strange directions. This is called the Madonna with the long neck. And you can see a number of very strange things here, one of them being, of course, this very long neck on the Virgin, and this elongated body. And notice how long the fingers are. They're just like tentacles here. It's very grossly distorted. And then some strange composition of the picture. She is in the center as the more important image. But here we have just this leg. We don't even see the person it's connected to. Rather strange. Strange to put that type of bare leg in conjunction with the picture of the Virgin Mary here. But then we have this very strange perspective, too. She's gigantic compared to this prophet in the distance. And then this row of columns, you can see just down here the little shadows that there really are many of these columns. They form sort of a solid wall, and what they're holding up remains in doubt. Strange items here, just composed in ways that were distinctly different from the Renaissance masters and somebody trying to distinguish themselves from the masters in these unusual ways. And here's Giambologna, a sculpture in bronze, which I find very, very intriguing. This was intended to give an idea of lightness and grace. Here's Mercury, the winged messenger. He's intended to look like he's entirely floating here. Of course, he has to be supported somehow. And down here we have one of these mythological gods with his head facing up. And this actually here is air being puffed out of his mouth. So that's what winged Mercury, this winged messenger, is dancing on. And it's quite an accomplishment to do this because bronze is, of course, heavy. And to support all of the weight on the very narrow sort of a little column down here of this sort of a piece of metal meant that the whole statue had to be very well balanced. So this had to be opposed by this, and the whole thing balanced in such a way that it wouldn't put an undue strain on that very small piece of metal and then fall over, having broken that off. And the artistry I find kind of interesting too, but definitely it was a more dramatic, a more interesting sort of a thing opposed than perhaps just standing still as it might have been done in the Renaissance. Now we find increasingly strange things going on here with Tintoretto. This is a scene, as Gombrich describes, of a body being snatched from a crypt in Alexandria where the legend has it that St. Mark was buried. St. Mark being the patron saint of Venice, these Venetians were going there to bring back his body, because in that era, holy relics like this were thought to be able to work all sorts of cures. And Gombrich will explain more about the cures that are being illustrated here, but suffice to say that what's being represented is rather unusual in terms of action. Stealing a body from a crypt, a body that might have been dead for 1,500 years, wouldn't necessarily be in the shape that we're looking at here, but assuming it was, this, having been removed from a crypt, is the body of the saint. But when they've identified finally his body and have it rummaged through a few other crypts to attempt to find it, the saint appears here and tells them essentially, don't go any farther, you found me. And they would drag back this body, and it would be, various parts of it would be used as relics in Catholic churches in Venice. So very, very strange, the kind of action going on here. And it's another element of departure from the way things would have been done in the Renaissance, in an era when artists were trying to come up with something different. And this too, Tintoretto, strangeness here in the way this is composed, St. George slaying the dragon, part of biblical lore. The strange thing being, of course, although the main figure of the action is in the center, this figure here, somebody running away from the scene, is even more prominent and sort of coming straight at you. So you'll notice more action here than typically in Renaissance paintings, and that grows as we approach the next era, which is called the Baroque, where a lot of theatrics and a lot of drama and activity is the hallmark of those types of paintings. Now we come to a very interesting fellow here, El Greco, Domenicos Theotocopoulos, easier to call him El Greco. Here we have something done in Spain. El Greco studied to some extent in Rome, and he could paint in a more traditional manner, but he increasingly grew into this type of, it looks even like modern art in the way that bodies are distorted and colors are used and strange sort of a background here, not really an attempt to be overly realistic, portraying a scene of horror from the Book of Revelation where one of the seals is being opened and these saints here who have previously been martyred, calling for revenge and retribution on the people still on earth who may have perpetrated their deaths. So it's a strange kind of a painting. It played well in Spain. It remained much more conservative and somewhat detached from the concepts of the Renaissance until a bit later, when these things were looked upon as being rather strange and only in the modern era recognized as great works of art. El Greco also created portraiture of a much more standard variety. So we see that at one point in his career, El Greco actually was somewhat traditional. He painted this and other portraits, but later grew to adopt a style that was far different. Not mannerist, but just very different in terms of how he pictured the human form. Now, at this point, this chapter 18 diverges from this exploration of mannerist art and begins to take a look at changes in art in Northern Europe wrought by the Protestant Reformation. So I'm going to put the discussion of that into a second part of this lecture in the second video.